Welcome to Stunt Stories. I'm Corey Eubanks. Today, I have with me one of my best friends who has tolerated me for many, many years. I've always looked up to him because, well, he's very tall. That's why they call him Too Tall. His name is Danny Winans. Danny, thank you so much for being on Stunt Stories.
Thank you, Corey. Pleasure to be with you and always to have looked down at you. I appreciate that. Thank you, buddy.
Have you noticed how throughout the years, and I could prove this, when we would take photos together, you would always position ourselves so that I got to stand up on the sidewalk, on the curb, and you would be in the street, so I seemed like I was taller.
It's something I learned over many years. You don't ever want to shame the little people, and it's better to look in your eye.
Well, I want you to know
to have that.
It's been greatly appreciated. I mean, I know the secrets, you know, cat's out of the bag. It's a big, you know, a lot of people used to think, gosh, I think Corey was that tall. And I think it's very dishonest and misleading, but I really appreciate you doing that for me throughout the years.
Oh, anytime, buddy, anytime.
Hey, you know, looking back on your career, I can't recall, because we've done so much together, I can't recall what the first job was that you and I actually worked on together. Can you?
Wow. Boy, I'm going to have to test my memory right there. Good Lord.
Well, I know. I mean,
I know it was before Knight Rider, and that was like 2008, I think, but it was well.
I mean,
God, I'm trying to.
Yeah, because you go way back to, like, I mean, Captain America and Stone Cold. What about that movie, Stone Cold?
Oh, that was an epic. That was a great. That was a gentleman who you know well, who you were first introduced to, Paul Baxley, was the stunt coordinator. When I came in, and his son, Craig Baxley, was directing it and had just taken that show over from, oh my God, I can't even put together the director's name who had it, but it had changed hands. And I came to work on that mainly to do camera bike work, covering for a guy named Scott Dockstetter, who I'm sure you know well back from the days of Chips and whatnot. That was an epic film. Brian Bosworth, you know, straight out of Oklahoma College at the time. The Boz was a famous football player in college. Talked about going pro, and next thing he's starring in a movie. You know, it was one of those great films. A lot of debauchery back in those days. You know, I was running around with Matt Johnson, who's another name out of our past.
Well, didn't you become Brian Bosworth's stunt double?
I did not.
Wait a minute.
You know why? I was too tall.
Oh, you were?
Yes. I actually went in to be looked at for him when the show belonged to Steve Boyum and Dick Zeiker, that were the first stunt coordinators on it. And then somewhere along the line, there was a falling out. I think the director got fired. And don't quote me on this, but I think those guys got replaced, and Paul Baxley came in, and his son Craig took over the directorial position on that.
Well, then who am I thinking of that you spent a lot of time? I'm like on Broken Arrow.
Oh, that was Howie Long.
Howie Long.
Yeah, another football player.
Yeah, yes. Another big guy.
Yeah, that was a good job for, you know, Alan Graf.
That was a good job for you. Wasn't that with John Woo directing?
John Woo directed, Alan Graf was a stunt coordinator, that changed hands a little bit, in the interim of that film due to some other issues, that probably don't need to be going into, but.
Are you telling me that there's political things in the entertainment
industry?
You know,
there are political things.
I've never known that till just now.
Who would know?
Who would think?
I can't wear my Let's Go Brandon shirt on the set without, you know,
offending
my career.
Yeah. And Brandon's actually a great guy, and Let's Go Brandon is a great thing to say.
We love him.
So when you had a really incredible action sequence to do on a train on that Broken Arrow movie, from what I recall.
And that came about, that period of the film, Alan Graf, let go or walked away. I'm not sure on which position that he took, but at that point, Gary Himes came in to take the show over, and they had gotten with John Woo, and they had written in a sequence with this train that involved a nuclear weapon getting loaded onto it, going through all the paces of it, I ended up having this gag to do, getting blown out of the side of the stock car by Christian Slater's character swinging on a, basically on a piece of high-tech cable, coming through and swinging and kicking me or my character out of the side of this train. That led into, I want to say it was probably, you know, 165 to 175, 80 feet, kind of a backwards fall, getting blown out of this train.
Oh, come on, Danny. We know that was all CGI. You were on a sound stage down there in Burbank somewhere.
Yeah, Burbank, green screen, having a latte.
Oh, my God. Nice. I mean, that back when you were doing that stuff, that was hardcore real stunts, man. That was like, something's going to go wrong. You're going to plummet to the ground.
Well, they had a system and great guys who was Brian Smurs. Was rigging it with Jeff Haberstad, both really solid guys. Pat Romano was involved with it as well, doing a lot of the rigging on this film. Was another, you know, pretty credible, outstanding rigger.
Okay, I get that. I know those names you just dropped are huge, huge names in our industry. But still, at that time, way back then, weren't you guys still in somewhat of the experimental stage?
For me particularly, because I was probably one of the bigger guys to do this particular, which really was done by Dar Robinson, the decelerator system, which, you know, is basically a free fall cable system that employs a very short braking system at the end of its end mark, which... You know, Mike, you know, at that time I was 240 pounds, 6'5". I was a big guy. They were worried about the stress loads and the cables we could use because, you know, by then it still was in the era where you weren't, you know, what you had to paint out cable wise and things of that nature, rotoscoping and other things.
This decelerator, was that the one that had the fan with the fan blades?
No, that's a descender. The decelerator is basically like a ram system, a big hydraulic cylinder. And this particular one was on, I want to say like an 8-to-1 pull or 9-to-1. It was an 8-foot stroke, I think. So it put like 70 feet of braking and, you know, and whatever the height of the fall was. In my mind, I can't remember. It was like, you know, like I said, 160 to 180, somewhere in that neighborhood. Wow. So it had a lot of G-force pulling down. You know, it had a good over 100, I want to say probably about 100 to 110 feet of free fall in it, you know, which was pretty invigorating for a guy that had never gone more than, you know, 40 or 50 feet high falls. So it was a step up.
Hey, just between you and me, did you scream at all? Did you have like a little, did you scream?
No, I don't think I had a little scream.
I would have.
I did a big blow push backwards. It looked like I was bench pressing when I was standing on the side of the bridge to do the decelerator part of the fall. The first part of that sequence was basically the train going at speed over the bridge, which again, you know, was up near a couple hundred feet in the air. And I got ratcheted out of the train about 20 feet out of the train and then decelerated about another drop of 15 feet or so to start the sequence. Yeah. And that was more, to me, that was more scary than doing the actual decelerator fall because it was a lot of velocity coming out of the train.
And the train was moving, correct?
Train was moving at 25 and you're out in the ozone and the next thing you're blown out and you've come off a nice wooden floor and the next thing you're just in the ozone and hoping everything's working well. Yeah.
God, how nerve-wracking.
Yeah. It was a lot of fun. It was a good payday. And, you know, the guys around me, it was a really good team of guys on it. So, you know, I felt really confident about what we were doing. You know, like any stunt, you want to, you know, there's always a scare factor in my mind to everything because you want to think about anything that can go wrong and hope nothing goes wrong.
Yeah. I could remember the stories that were floating around. You know how that is. You guys, what were you in Utah or where were you filming that?
That was up in Lewistown, Montana.
Oh, Montana. So you're in Montana. And so by the time the story comes back, what you just clarified, you know, we're hearing all kinds of things. I'm like, that's just insanity what you guys are doing. I mean, it still sounds crazy to me what you guys were actually doing, yanking you, you know, ratcheting you out of that moving train. And God, just if one thing had gone wrong, we wouldn't be having this conversation right now.
Yeah, no, exactly. I have to tell you though, I mean, that is, I mean, to have that opportunity, you know, as a stuntman to, you know, be in a position to get that kind of a gag. Cause you know, a lot of our work is, it's not every day we're out doing heavy work. You know, I'd like to say we are, but you know, a lot of times we're ND drivers, you're number 15 in a pack of 30 guys, or you're sitting at the cafe dodging a gunfire. So to get a big, you know, kind of moment in a Hollywood gag that makes you want to be a stuntman when you're a kid, those kind of things, I was really, you know, I felt very blessed to have that moment. Yeah. And to, you know, and to have a good crew of people around me, and to work for John Woo, who, you know, high action Chinese director. I mean, he's pretty renowned in that field. So,
you know, for a moment there, for a moment there, you were making our profession sound pretty boring and pretty lame. You like, a lot of sitting around.
Stars. You can cut that part out.
but it's so
get
true.
Get the beeper. Yeah.
How many? Well, hey, what about Waterworld?
Oh my, that was great. That's another epic.
I know.
That was months and months of playing in the ocean in Hawaii in warm water, great pay. I mean, there was 50 plus guys and girls on it in our department alone in stunts. You know, Big Stunts Unlimited job, which, you know, is a strong organization in the film business, especially in our arena. And, yeah.
Wow.
Good Lord, we can say, working for R.A. Rondell, I mean, he took great care of everybody. He laid out a great job and, you know, Tony's food and sushi every day and cash and Mai Tais. What more could a guy want?
You're making our occupation sound very glamorous now.
It is.
You went from boring and dull and mundane to
super glamorous.
Super glamorous Hawaii. And yeah. Hey,
Hawaii.
You and I worked together on Mission Impossible too. Do you remember that?
Yes.
Another John Woo film.
Awesome. Yeah. I forgot about that one.
Yeah. You did the Fast and the Furious.
I did. The original. Did a lot with Mick Rogers, Rob Cohen directing, another, you know, and that's a funny because you've worked on a good handful of the Fast and Furious and done some nice gags on those as well. That, especially that big bus cannon you did was phenomenal.
That was all CGI.
I know. It was the other guy, CGI guy, he did a great job.
He did a great job.
But when we were doing the Fast and Furious, which originally was called Redline.
Oh, was it really? I didn't know that.
Yeah. Yeah. It was called Redline. And then they changed the name to Fast and Furious. But, you know, it was one of those films when we're working on it, we're like, who's this Vin Diesel guy? Right. And I like Vin. He's a nice, super nice guy. And I got to work with him a few times since. But we were thinking this thing's going to be a turd. You know, we kind of thought, oh, is this another like B movie? You know, it's cool for us. Good cars, a lot of racks, high speed, you know, had all the elements for, you know, good looking girls, fast cars and stunts. That was the whole formula.
Paul Walker.
Yeah. But, you know, we didn't know who those guys were.
Yeah.
Vin
back
Diesel.
Then.
I mean, you know, obviously when you look at him, you don't think like he's not like Cary Grant or, you know. Robert Redford coming your way.
Yeah, it's like he fell out of an ugly tree and hit every branch with his face on the way down.
Well, thank God he's got a pretty stunt double, though, Troy Robinson.
Yeah. No, I had heard that Vin Diesel years ago had tried to make it in the stunt industry. Is that true or no?
You know what? I don't know that. I couldn't comment on
it's
that.
It's like Burt Reynolds, you know, oh yeah, he was a stuntman before he became an actor. And
I'm yeah.
Like, but that part was true. Did you know that?
Yeah, Bert. Yes. Yeah. That I did know. Yeah.
I didn't know if that was true with Vin.
Yeah, I don't know with Vin. I can't recall that anywhere that I've heard that, but he's definitely made his mark in the film industry.
Oh my God, yeah. Yeah, and I understand that Vin Diesel and Dwayne Johnson, aka The Rock, they don't like each other.
I heard that. Now, were you not on some of those projects when they were mingling as actors?
The first one was Fast Five, when they first introduced Dwayne Johnson. And I worked on every single unit on that film, from the train sequence that we shot before they even started principal photography. Then I went in Parker, Arizona, and then went down to, Puerto Rico, went to Atlanta, but I never saw those two gentlemen together on the same set.
Huh.
So I didn't know what their relationship was. I just had heard that they did not like one another and that it was real. And I thought maybe you might know because you've worked with them as well.
Yeah. I unfortunately don't know. I don't know much about them.
Let's start a rumor. Yeah. Let's just start it now that they don't like each other.
I think it started. I think it started a while back.
So who was, other than Howie Long, who has been the one actor that you have performed stunts for the most, or did you ever have someone like that you were just on?
No, honestly, I'm a guy here. My sizes I've shrunk a bit, as I've matured a little bit and compressed over the years. But I started out in stunts. I'm 6'5". I've ran from 230 to 250 pounds. My world of, people to double has been really more character actors. I've probably doubled 100 different tall guys. I briefly doubled Tim Robbins. I went up to double Seagal one time up in Alaska on Deadly Ground, and I was probably the third guy in. I think Jeff Dashnall was doubling. He left that show, I think. I don't know if he left it or was busy on something else.
I've heard nothing but horror stories about Steven Seagal.
Yeah. I didn't have a good time with him in the least, and I didn't even end up doubling him. It was kind of a shit show getting up there.
Gene Hartline, who's unfortunately no longer with us, he was telling me some stories about him working with him, and he would actually really punch the stunt guys.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
He's probably the most, I don't know. He was, my meeting with him was short. I got a rush call from Genie at Stunts Unlimited years back. This is probably 92 or 93. And Danny Epper, another large stuntman, from the Epper family.
Yeah.
He was up doubling Seagal. And apparently there was some issue. I don't know if it was to do with the coordinator or financial problems or something happened. Danny left the show. And I mean, just left. And I don't think he spoke to anybody. I think he got on a plane and quit. And I knew I was kind of already in line. I was hearing some rumors about that. And I got a rush call from Genie, the secretary of Stunts Unlimited, and got hustled up the next morning up to Valdez, Alaska, and ran into Michael Runyard, who was helping Glenn Randall run the show up there. And the sequence in Valdez had to do with oil rigs and firefighters, kind of like the old John Wayne Hellfighters movie
These
guys that would blow up oil derricks that were on fire and put them out. Seagal was that guy. So I got a call to go up there and double him, which I was kind of excited because it was firework. I'm pretty comfortable in that, and I like that arena. And I thought, this is right up my alley. I was climbing around the oil derricks and fire, and I thought, great, this will be right up my alley. So cut to me getting into Valdez, getting out of the van, getting to the set. Michael Runyard comes up to me, who I know very well, and him and I, give each other our bro hugs and talk about how everything's going, and we start walking up towards Seagal's trailer and base camp, and we're probably 100 yards away. And I see Seagal in the kind of by his trailer, and he's pinning me visually and Runyard as we're walking up. And I'm looking at Runyard. I go, man, that guy looks like he's giving me the stink eye. So as we get closer, the introductions get made, and he's checking me out like you kind of check out a woman, right? He's giving me the up and down, and now I'm looking at him, right? He's big, he's heavy, he's got a belly on him, right? I don't think the gentleman could even see his feet at this point. And I'm keep myself in pretty good shape. So, you know, I can see my feet. I'm fairly, you know, decent shape. And
well, no wonder he was checking you out. You're tall and handsome and you're in shape.
Well, I think he didn't like that my hair was, you know, kind of a blondish grayish at the time. Anyway, he's stink eyeing me and we start getting into a conversation. We make our introductions, go through that blah, blah, blah. And the next thing he starts, he actually physically reaches over and kind of pokes on my chest and shoulder areas. And he goes, man, you're kind of big. And I'm like, well, you know, I give him my sizes and we talk a little bit about the sequence, which I'm extremely comfortable in doing all that. And we get back again. It starts more of the up and down looking me over. And he pushes on me again. And I'm like, I'm kind of now stepping back a little bit and I'm not very comfortable with that. And I'm thinking, man, just touch me again. I think we're going to have an issue here. So he's looking at me and he goes, well, you know, you're just kind of big. So at this point, I know he doesn't like me as his double. Not that you would never know. It could be you for the work we're doing, Corey, size wise, right? It's all high work up in the air, fire. You wouldn't really know. Anyway, he says, man, he goes, you're just kind of big. And I just looked right at him and I remember it very well. I said, well, I normally double bigger men. And that was the end of our conversation. And I turned around. I looked at Mike Runyard as we walked away. I go, am I on a window or aisle seat? I said, I'm good either way. He goes, oh, no, you're going to stay. I ended up staying on the film. They ended up bringing in Brian Simpson, who's darker haired. I thought he was a good double for him as well. I mean,
oh my gosh.
But yeah, that was my Seagal moment.
You know,
I stayed on that show for a few weeks and did some ND work and I called it a day.
I love that story, whether it's true or false. I know there's some people that say it never happened about Gene LaBelle choking out Steven Seagal. Is that the story that you heard?
That's the story I heard.
In New York.
I heard of. Yeah, I heard that he said nobody could get a move on him or something. And LaBelle, the story I heard is LaBelle says, well, I can or something. And I heard he got a hold of him, choked him out and put him into a little sleeper mode like LaBelle does. And, you know, the rumors has he pissed his pants and that whole thing. I
love that part.
I hope it's true.
I love that part of the rumor.
I do too. I hope it's true. Yeah. He would be my least favorite actor I've ever been around in my career.
Yeah. He used to actually live up by me, and my first wife and I were at this little diner in Los Olivos, and he was in there with Kelly LeBrock. Cause I remember my wife at the time, she pointed her out. So look at Kelly LeBrock. And I'm like, oh, and that's Steven Seagal. And then this is right after that thing with Gene LaBelle. I mean, like weeks after. And we're getting ready to leave. And I stand up and, you know, I see out of the corner of his eye, he's looking at us because we're moving, you know, in his peripheral vision. And I look towards the door and I go, hey, Gene, hey, LaBelle, like that. And I start to walk out and my wife goes, who's Gene LaBelle? I go, doesn't matter. Just get in the car. Let's go. Cause he snapped his head. Looking outside, like, is Gene LaBelle really here?
Oh, that's awesome.
Yeah.
That's awesome. Hey, you know, it's funny when you bring him up and you brought up Gene Hartline, who I love. And Gene Hartline, was a guy who's, was very helpful in my career as well. I mean, and he was a really good guiding light and funny. And just, you know, he was a one-of-a-kind character.
I loved that man. He would call and check on me out of the blue just for no reason. Just seeing how you're, seeing how you're doing.
Great. You know, Seagal loves him. And the guy you can get to validate that, who's another great stuntman, is Jim Wilkie. And because I was with those guys up in Alaska. Wilkie was there and Hartline. But Seagal loves, I think he would be one of his favorite stuntmen.
No kidding.
Hartline. Yeah. Which I just always found odd, but you know, Hartline in his great delivery would always keep him somewhat entertained.
God. You mentioned Jim Wilkie. What a living legend that man is.
Yeah.
Wow.
Absolutely.
I remember first meeting him. We were doing Midnight Run.
Yeah.
Robert De Niro years ago. And I met
great
him.
Film.
Yeah. Hey, what did you get to do on The Lone Ranger?
On The Lone Ranger, I worked doing, they had about 20 of us or so on this big bandstand for sequence in the town that they built in outside of Albuquerque, that this train that Johnny Depp, who's Tonto, I guess, is on, and he gets a hold of running the train, and he ends up pulling or hitting this staged band or this bandstand that we're all on and collapses it, and we all get just go to the ground, basically a little, you know, pratfalls and backfalls and things like that.
Yeah. Hey, what about what about the movie Dumb and Dumber?
Dumb and Dumber. Yeah, I was on that. Was on Dumb and Dumber. That's the sequel. I worked driving a semi tractor on that, chasing the two characters that was supposed to be, I guess, Jim Carrey and Jeff Daniels, I believe, were the characters in that.
Yeah.
Chasing them in on Sand Canyon in a Zamboni. They were driving a modified Zamboni from an ice rink, and I was encroaching and pushing on them in a big conventional semi tractor.
What about the movie Chips? Did you get to do? I mean, that's right up your alley. Motorcycles.
Yeah, you know what? Sadly, I like to say a lot, Corey, but I did some nondescript driving on that, and some ND foot stuff, jumping out of the way of some motorcycles and car chase coming through a big park sequence.
You know what's the beauty about this, though, Danny?
Yeah,
is you could pretty much say you did anything, and they're going to believe you. Whoever's listening,
I know. You know, I'm not a good liar.
I know. I remember one time, a good friend of mine, Russell Solberg, who doubled John Voight on a movie called Runaway Train. And I was actually working for Russell, and I saw him, and I was telling some stunt stories, just some other younger stunt people on set. We were, you know, laughing and telling stories. And I saw Russell walking over to see what we were talking about. So I segued into the movie Runaway Train. I go, when I won the stunt award for when I was doubling John Voight. Now, I didn't double John Voight. I did not win a stunt award. It was Russell. Right. So I just told the story about how I was on top of the train going through the snow at 70 miles an hour. And Russell comes over and staring at me. I could just feel his eyes stabbing me in the side of the face because I was telling the story that he won the stunt award for, but I told it as if it were me. And one of the stunt guys I was telling the story to, he goes, well, Corey, isn't John Voight like Russell's height? And I go, well, yes, actually, but you know, see, the director wanted the train to look much larger, so he. Right. And I just ripped off his stunt story right in front of his face.
Oh. Yeah, well, sadly, there are guys out there that actually do that.
Yeah, I'm one of them. I'm one.
No.
Hey, what did you do on Cowboys and Aliens?
Cowboys and Aliens, I did, I do a lot of camera bike work and do a lot of chase filming stuff. So I actually went there to shoot some of the horse chase work we had done. I had one of my little trick vehicles. I've got a little Yamaha Rhino is what it's called, a little quad car. So I went and just did a bunch of chase work. I'd like to tell you something exciting, but it was... just bread and butter kind of work for me on that.
Yeah. You know, it's funny. I stumbled across some photos of you and I down in Long Beach or San Pedro, I think it might've been. And we were working for Michael Bay on Transformers, Dark of the Moon. And we were all leaning on we're on the freeway. We're leaning up against the center K rail. And we all had that same exact look on our face. Like we were just miserable.
Yeah, I thought it though. I think I recall that photo. It looked like a good sunglass ad, if I'm not mistaken.
Yes, we were all wearing the shades.
Our big buddy Henry Kinji was in there somewhere.
Yes. Yeah. I can't. You got to get me his phone number. I can't find a phone number on Henry Kinji to save my life.
Oh, I will send you all his stuff. Yeah, absolutely. He's hard to reach, but I do stay in touch with him every couple months. Touch base.
Yeah, he's a great guy.
I
love Henry Kinji. Hey, what did you do on Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles?
I worked with Jim Wilkie, and I went up there and ran this. They had I think it was a cab over semi. I can't recall if it was a cab over a conventional, which, you know, it's just the difference in the front end on it. But we had a semi-trailer rig that we could throw 270-degree slides in.
Yes, I've seen that. It's pretty accurate, yeah.
Yeah, we did it all in the snow. We were doing it for Dan Bradley on his second unit. Scott Rogers was coordinating it. And the thing about that, which was really kind of cool and was new, that really hadn't been done, is I drove the tractor part, so I could throw the tractor, or not the tractor, excuse me, drove the trailer end of it. And the trailer had a 500 horsepower V8 motor in it, so we could drive from the trailer, so we could do like reverse 180s in it. So I would steer the trailer system, which I had a kind of a portal cut out of the back of the sleeper of the semi itself, so I could always look at the trailer when I was jackknifing it or throwing it around. I could see what parameters I always could throw it to. But we also had a video set up on it, so I could have some reference to the ground to try to drive it, because we needed to get it at speed, which was hard to do. It was a 53-foot trailer. Didn't really have the best steering components on it. But anyway, we would throw reverse 180s, 270s up in the snow. We did a lot of different jackknife stuff with it. Actually, it was a really fun job for me and for Jim Wilkie. I loved being with him for a couple weeks in that truck. And, you know, we worked up by Lake Placid, New York in the winter. Did a lot of big, they did a big green screen snow setup on Long Island for good, like almost 1,000 yards of green screen. I think it was awesome.
Wow. That's yeah. A big set.
Yeah. It was a pretty exciting, you know, it was a fun job. You know, it was one of those good break the bank kind of movies.
What about Ford versus Ferrari?
Ford versus Ferrari. I'd like to say that I drove all the bitchin' cars, but I didn't, because I'm too big. Couldn't fit in any of the race cars, but I drove a lot of vintage ND cars.
Is that true? Those little sports cars you can't fit in?
I don't think I could fit in them.
See, I could fit in just about anything.
Anything, I know. I'm still things that you have. The only thing, like my career, the thing I want to get is a nice Cannon, and I've never had one. And I always get, well, you're too big. And then I always refer to, well, Henry Kinji.
Yeah, you guys are about the same height.
Same height. I don't know.
Scoot,
but whatever.
Scoot,
I
mean, the seat back a little bit, right?
I'll go put my own seat in. I'll have, just let me get in.
Yeah.
That being said, yeah, I just drove a lot of vintage cars on that through some ND stuff. Really fun job. Had a lot of good people on it. I'd like to say I did something super hairy and heavy, but no.
Well, it was a great film.
Yeah.
A good movie. And have you, are you working on anything at the moment, or are you just taking a little time off for the holidays?
Well, I just finished up from a job that you had the pleasure of working on, that Transformers 7.
Yeah. Why do they call it Transformers 7 when they only had Transformers 5? Then they did the Bumblebee movie.
Right. I think that's how they're equating it. The title on the, that I dealt with was E-77.
Yeah.
So I, and from what I gather, which you probably gathered as well, that this is the beginning of a new trilogy.
Yeah.
From what I heard.
Yeah.
So,
well, yeah, I was on it. I was working on that film up there in Canada for 3.5 months and then supposed to go to Peru. And then I looked at the list of everybody who was going to Peru and I saw your name was on there. And I said, I think I'm just going to head home. I don't want you standing next to me making me feel short. Hey, Danny.
Dude, you would have rocking. Are you kidding? Peru, you'd have been a giant. Tom Elliott was taller than everybody. Those little Incans, they were everywhere.
Hey, buddy, I got to tell you something. I could sit and talk with you for hours and hours, and all I'm going to hope is that you will come on Stunt Stories again and share some more stories with us at another time.
Absolutely. It was fun.
That'd
We'd
be
have
awesome.
To do it again, maybe over a few tequila shots like we did on Hawaii 5-0 a couple years ago.
That would be fun. That's it. We'll do it next time.
I would love that.
Danny, thank all you right. so much. I love you, buddy.
Yeah, Corey.
Okay.
Thanks, buddy. You as well.
All right, bye-bye.
All right, buddy.
Thanks for listening to Stunt Stories.